radiology is a very different field. How come you I read that you are interested in reading photography as well as traveling in historical places? So these affects on your
writing.
When
I go to a historical place, I always like to sit there and get a feel of the things. Like if I go to a fort, I go to see a Sinagar or Pratapgarh, I always like to sit there. And I have been to some of these places while writing the book. I went to Sinagar, Pratapgarh, you know, some places. So I used to sit there and try to imagine how Chhatrapati Shivaji would have probably looked across the rampart of the fort and looked across like the enemy armies or whatever. And just try to imagine, get a feel of the geography around the fort, something like that. That helps always in writing the book, because ultimately when you write historical fiction, now my book is historical fiction, it is fiction but based on genuine history. I mean, none of the events in the book are fake events, they are all from history books. The only thing is that the book, I mean, each event has been described in my words or by my imagination. That is what I have imagined that the event would have taken place this year. So if you want to describe a particular event, a battle or something, then it's always good if you know the geography, if you know actually how the fort stands or something. So it always helps.
But why Shivaji? Why do you write everything on Shivaji? Why not Krishna or any other? Or any other Rajput or anybody? Why not? Why only Shivaji?
Shivaji is just a start. I mean, Marathi manus ahe manun Shivaji. Marathi manusacha manamadhye nehmi Shivaji pahilaj yeto. Rana Pratap yacha adhi Shivajis yeto nehmi. Jari Rana Pratap ek 100 varsha adhi hote. Although Rana Pratap was 100 years before Shivaji. As a Maharashtrian, I would always think of Shivaji first. But I mean, what you're saying is right. I have started studying on Rana Pratap's history also. Probably someday I'll write a book on him also. And I do, I mean, it is a dream that I will write on more of these personalities from Indian history. There is one particular reason why I wanted to write on history. Is that when I started reading history books, I realized that our impression of history, the impression of a common Indian man, person's history of India, is what has been put into our minds by the Britishers. Okay, the way we imagine our past has a lot to do with how the Britishers put across our history to us. And the way they put across our history to us was to suit them. It was not really to bring out the true history of India. It was to suit them. They wanted to subdue us. They wanted to continuously prove to us that you are inferior. And that is the reason why they put our history across to us in that way. It is only when now after independence that Indian historians have started writing more and more books that you are getting actually an Indian perspective of our history. And if you look at the way Indian history is portrayed, I mean, how does a Westerner look at India? Right? Westerner will look at India as, okay, great Mughals, the Mughal Empire, Taj Mahal, that is all they know about. But they don't really know what the Mughal Empire did to India, or what, you know, how the Indians got enslaved in that. And across the world, I don't think any of these stories of maybe Shivaji or Rana Pratap or Lakshmi Bai or even Prithviraj Chauhan, any of these stories are very famous, because all the Western mind knows about Indians, Mughals, and you know all the Islamic rulers who ruled over India for 1,000+ years. So somewhere we have to tell our own stories in English, not just in Marathi or just in English, so that the people outside India can also probably read and learn.
Great. We'll start with your initial stage of that name of the book. From where it came?
I don't know how many of you have heard about a movie called 300. The movie is based on a very famous battle which was fought between the Greek armies and the Persian armies at Thermopylae. And it is said that 300 Spartans defended a pass, a mountain pass, against a huge Persian army. And that's how that movie was made, 300. Now, if you look at Shivaji's history, the Battle of Pavankhind is almost exactly the same. Okay. It is, we don't really know how many exact number of people were there with Baji Prabhu Deshpande or with Shivaji. But it is assumed and based on a lot of the papers that there were about 600 people when he left from Panagarh, and out of which half stayed with Baji Prabhu at Pavan Khind and half went with Shivaji to Vishalgarh. So Baji Prabhu would have defended the pass with about 300 people, and so the name of the book is from those 300 people who defended the pass, because if you see the importance of that battle, if Baji Prabhu had not defended that pass, it was a sort of a rear guard action, you know. A big army is pursuing the king. Somebody has to stop the army so that the king can move ahead and escape. If Baji Prabhu had not done that, Shivaji would probably have been killed at that time. And the struggle would have ended right there. So it's a very crucial battle in Shivaji's life, in history. And I have ended the book with that battle. So I decided to name the book
based on that battle. Give one example, that on 13 July, few people travelled 40 miles and they reached at 7 p.m. On 14 July. So all this information, from where you get all this information? How did you collect it, all this information? Have you gone through any reference book on it's a you are reading, or what the references are you able to give it to us?
Actually, I have read a lot of books. So there are some...
It's very specific, no? That's why I'm asking.
There are some sources of history which you take as primary sources. So those will be in Marathi, there will be the Bakhars or the Chronicles, Japan, Manko, Savasya, Bakhar. And then there are the Persian sources, the Mughal court histories and Nadir Shahi court histories, etc. And then there are a lot of letters, you know, letters written by Shivaji's offices, letters written by Shahaji's offices, letters written by, from the Rajasthan, you know, Jaipur offices. So all these form the primary sources. And then there will be several other secondary sources and tertiary sources. So I have collected some of the basic primary sources which are available in print today. And in addition to that, I've also referred to books by modern historians. So in particular, if you are asking, then there is a historian called Gajanan Bhaskar Mahindar, Mr. Mahindar. And he's a very senior historian and he's written extensively on Shivaji and Aurangzeb also. And I have used his books to a great extent, and he's also helped me. I keep meeting him all the time and he keeps, you know, we sit and talk for 2 hours and he keeps telling me a lot of things. So I've learned a lot from him.
I would like to ask you one thing. While going, in your blog, you have written, it's a history, it's a, and on front page, it's a novel. But read a story means what? Is it a novel or is it a story?
It is a novel. In Marathi, what you would call as kadambari, something similar to what Ranjit Desai created in Srimadhyamudi. But it is definitely based on authentic history. There is nothing in the book which is not given in the history books. And of course, in the context of Shivaji's history, there are a lot of stories which are not really proven by sources or papers, but they have been traditionally told over generations, you know, like Kalyancha Subedarachi Soon Mantra. Some of these stories have been traditionally told to from father to son or from over generations. Although you don't find any proof of these stories in history books. So wherever I have used those stories, I have actually indicated at the end of the book that this is a story which is not proven or confirmed. And it has been told as a story. But the rest, everything is from
history. What is different in 300 Brave Men and other Marathi book? In short,
as we were discussing sometime before, I was telling him that, you know, the picture of Shivaji in every Maharashtrian's mind is the picture created by Mr. Babasaheb Purandare.
Absolutely.
And he was the first person to actually put Shivaji in front of us. And the way he has portrayed, I think most of us will still imagine Shivaji as the way he has written in his books. Somewhere, even Sriman Yogi, Mr. Ranjit Desai, has done a fabulous job with Sriman Yogi. But somewhere, I when I read about Shivaji, I felt that to some extent my idea was slightly different from theirs. I think most Marathi writers would have written that there was a tremendous influence of Jizabai on Shivaji, which is okay, which I agree to. But a person like Shivaji who reached to the stature that he did, I really wouldn't agree that he would have been influenced to that extent by his mother. I think somewhere down the line, when he became an adult, he would certainly have become, you know, his own man and would have taken his own decisions rather than being influenced by his mother so much. So that is the way, to some extent, I have portrayed. In my book, you will find that Jizabai's influence on Shivaji has been downplayed to some extent. Then Shivaji has been portrayed by a lot of Marathi authors as a very, very sensitive and khup bhavuk tyala portray kelela hai baryachya Marathi authors. Maza asa mat hai, like I feel he was probably not that. A person who reached to that stature could not have been that sensitive, or, you know, he would have been more of a hardened man. Like, so I have sort of put him across as that, a less emotional compared to what he has been portrayed in Marathi books. And yeah, I mean, some other things like his relationship with his father, I try to portray that. Most books will not portray the early life of Shivaji. You know, I have started my book when he's around 11 years old, and the early few years before he started his struggle against Adichya, those years I have tried to portray, which are not really portrayed in many books today. So try to put his relation with his father and also with Naduji Kondev in a slightly different light. Again, most Marathi books will portray Dadoji Kondev as a tremendous influence on him, and I have tried to slightly portray that in a different manner. I still feel that Shivaji was such a intense personality that he probably, the influence by these two individuals, the three, or maybe his parents and Dadoji, was not to that great extent as what is portrayed in our books.
You have written a very good book on a very important man of Maharashtra as well as India. So what are the feelings you feel, and how the things are developed?
Actually, writing historical fiction is slightly easy to that extent because you don't have to imagine a new story. The story is already there in front of you. Right? You know what Shivaji's life is. We know the story. There's nothing new about it. So what I used to do is I used to sit with history books and I used to create a sort of a timeline. Date-wise, year-wise, these are the events which have happened. Okay. So now you know the exact events portrayed in the history books. And then you start describing each event like a story. Start narrating each event like a story. So like, if Shivaji went to Bangalore to meet his father when he was 11. So then you try to imagine how he and his father would have met, because that was practically their first meeting. Shivaji left Maharashtra when Shivaji was 6 years old, and after that he has hardly seen Shivaji. And after 6 years of age, suddenly Shivaji sees him at about 11. So he hardly would have remembered his father at all. So how would the two react to meeting each other after such a long time? You know, something like that. So, and it is, what I used to do is I used to put myself in the place of the character and try to sort of emote in my mind what will happen, what would have happened. And I spent a lot of emotional moments, like, you know, while writing the last battle of Pavan Khinder, when Baji Prabhu is fighting with his men, I literally cried. When Sai Bai died and Shivaji, you know, when the scene was that he knew she was going to die, and he met her for the last time, and then he left Rajgarh and went to fight Afzal Khan. And so he was going for the most important battle of his life. A battle which could have claimed him, and he knew that his wife was going to die. He knew that he was not going to see her again. So, you know, how that moment would have played out. So, things like that. It gets very emotional at times. Sometimes when you're trying to describe a battle, you get very agitated and all. So, but it's a good platform.
Okay. It is written the part one, right? On your book. So, how many parts are going to come?
So actually what I've done is I've divided Shivaji's life into three parts. So Shivaji was born in 1630 and he died in 1680. He started his struggle roughly when he was about 16 years old. So 1646 would have been the time when he started. And the first phase of his career was entirely against Adil Shahi, almost entirely against Adil Shahi. This is up to around 1660. To that stage, he has hardly had any major battle against the Mughals. It is mostly against Adil Shahi. So my first book is up to 1660, and it ends with the Battle of Pawankin. The second book starts after the Battle of Pawankin, the invasion of Shahistan, and it ends in 1674 when Shivaji is crowned as the king, Chhatrapati. That phase of his career is almost entirely his battles are against Mughals. And 1674, after coronation, the 74 to 80 period will be the third book. So that's
it. तुम्हाला असं वाटलं नाही?